We are in the second part of lecture number two in our second class. What I did before the break, I went over basically path loss models, which are used for coverage. And I introduced you to a bunch of path loss models for indoor, urban, and suburban areas. Now, what I would like to do in this second part is start with telling you a little bit about other aspects. One of those aspects is this issue of fading that I told you earlier, which we refer to two of them. One of them is multipath fading, one of them is shadow fading. First, about multipath fading, I think I have one example in my other book that I have it in here. And that's a very nice example to understand what is the effect of multipath fading and gives you some intuition about it. This is we have an environment in here which is an open area. It has a ceiling in here and it has ground in here. And we have two mobile vehicles in there. These mobile vehicles could be automatic guided vehicles or whatever. These two are moving in this big area, which is inside of a manufacturing floor, for example, and they want to communicate with one another. The communication goes through three paths. One is the direct path between transmitter and receiver, which is this one. The other one is the path which is getting reflected from the ceiling. And the last one is this path which goes through the ground. So I have a three-path environment. Now, if I want to just simulate this environment, it's very easy. Because each of these paths that I want to calculate, I can calculate the received power and take the square root of that. That's the amplitude. Okay, received power, we know how to calculate it from those path loss models for the free space. Path loss model for free space, I can use it, and rather than d, I put this distance, the total distance of that path. So I have three distances. This is one distance, two distance, and three distances. And for all these, I can calculate the d and the amplitude of the received signal. Okay? And then from amplitude of the received signal, I can calculate tau, which is the delay of arrival, and based on that, I can calculate the phase of arrival, which is omega times tau. Okay? Then I have three paths, three magnitudes, and three phases. And I have to add them like a phasor. So I add one of them is in here, 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 and then this is the total. This is the sum of all three of them. If I do that in like a program, computer program, and I sketch it versus the distance, I end up with something like that. This equation that I have in here is how is this equation. Okay. Now, sometimes in the other classes I give this as an exercise. But not in here. In here, I just explain it. Okay. But if you do this simulation and you change your frequency, for example, for frequency of 100 megahertz, when you go from 1 meter up to 100 meter, you go like that. You have some slow fading in there. If you go to 1 gigahertz, you start to move faster. If you go to 10 gigahertz, you move even faster. But average drop of the power in all three of them is the same. Okay? So, basically, when I'm using due to multipath, these guys are moving back and forth. As I'm increasing the frequency of operation, as I increase the frequency of operation, rate of variations of these vectors is going to be changed and increased. Okay? And then, if I want to look at that, at 1 gigahertz, for example, I have something in between. At 100, my rate of variations is less. At 10 gig, my rate is the highest. But the average power in all cases, they come down the same way that they come. Okay? So, cause of multipath, this one shows you, number one, cause of multipath fading is multipath, obviously. In addition to that, it shows the sensitivity of the multipath to what frequency of operation. So when you say that, like, I go from 1 gigahertz to 2 gigahertz, my rate of variation is going to change. Okay? To go to 10 gigahertz, it changes. So if you design like a wireless LAN, which is around 900 megahertz is stable, you go at like 5 gigahertz, and you move around it, sometimes circuit cannot stand it. I mean, we had cases like that. Early designs of wireless LANs, when they were at high frequencies, you were going close to that and you were moving. It was stopping. Because when you move, you start to change the, I mean, the circuitry should follow you. And sometimes it doesn't, if you move fast. And then at higher frequencies, it can follow, channel is moving faster. So you need faster circuit to follow that. So rate of variation of the channel should be reflected to what? To the electronic in there. And as you increase your frequency, that becomes more challenging. That's the message which comes from here. Now, to go to the next slide, another issue which is important. So the first thing that I showed you in the other slide was that if you have a multipath environment, multipath causes multipath fading, which are fluctuations of the signal due to movements in distance. Okay? That's what we saw in the previous one. That's what we see in here. As I'm moving in here, as I'm moving, means my distance increases, my signal is fluctuating, and these fluctuations can be in the order of like 20, 30 dB. Okay? This is what I have in here. But these movements have been caused because I have like three paths. And these paths are changing the phase that they are adding to one another. So I call it multipath fading. Okay, so that's one cause of fluctuation. There is another phenomenon related to like a multipath environment, or actually related to radio communication. That one is referred to as Doppler shift or Doppler spectrum, which is reflecting the dynamic time amplitude fluctuations of the channel. Now, to just visualize that, one of my students, Steve Howard, did this experiment about like 15 years ago. And in this experiment, just I want to give you the intuition, not the mathematics, of how Doppler works and what is the meaning of Doppler shift. Doppler shift basically means that if you have a radio and it has like frequency of 900 megahertz, for example, you send 900 megahertz, you expect the receiver observes 900 megahertz. Okay? And that's correct if they are fixed. As soon as they start to move toward one another, that frequency changes slightly, a little bit. That's called Doppler shift. I mean, it can be shown very easily, but I think that's beyond a course like here. Just I want to tell you this phenomenon exists. And I show you the result of this experiment that he had. So, in a sense, in here, what he has done is that he sends a cosine, and this is the amplitude of the cosine in time, from 0 to 30 seconds. Okay? And at the beginning, he has... He has a wireless LAN environment. So he has a transmitter and a receiver. Both of them fixed. the antennas are like a few meter apart. And in 30 seconds, nobody moves around. And he measures the received signal strength. And it stays flat. So if he takes the Fourier transform of that, it would be an impulse. Means that he had one frequency centered at this location. Okay. Now, second time what he do in here, he starts to take these two antennas, one of them fixed, but he takes the other antenna and he moves that antenna randomly. Okay? So one antenna is fixed, the other antenna is moved by his hand, by the speed of his hand. So the rate of variation of the antenna is what? Is the rate of variations of his hand. Okay? And this is what you observe. In the same 30 seconds, the power is moving. Look at that. It's moving around like close to 40 dB. Just the distance is the same between transmitter and receiver. But I'm adding movements in there. When I move, what will happen? When I move the antenna, polarization of the antenna changes. And those phases which were coming in, they change. Okay? And the frequency changes. Okay? But anyway, if you take the Fourier transform of this, this is no more one cosine that you have received. You have a cosine with a spectrum. This spectrum is called Doppler spectrum, which is a spectrum of variation of your hand. It's reflecting movements of your hand. Okay? So when you come, now, in the second experiment, what he did was, he takes the transmitter and receiver, this time actually puts them fixed. Transmitter and receiver are fixed. But he forces people to move around the transmitter receiver. And this is what he gets at that time. Again, I have power fluctuation. If I get the spectrum, is like this. This spectrum, the width, is related to a speed of movement of the people, which is close to the speed of movement of hand. This bandwidth is related to what? That's like around 5 hertz. Okay? And this is around 5 hertz again. Okay? This 5 hertz, which is the spread of the original signal due to movement, is called Doppler spectrum. Okay? Now, in the third experiment, what he does, he takes one of the antennas and he just moves it cyclically. If it moves just cyclically, in the first one it was randomly, then what will happen, you see like a cosine, for example, in there. And the Fourier transform becomes like this. You have two peaks in there. Okay? But still the distance between the two peaks is what? Around the same 5 hertz. Because that's the speed of his hand. This is random speed. This is like more cyclic speed. Okay? So in a sense, a spread of the signal, a spectrum, it was only one cosine at one frequency. But I took it over the time, and I get that spread. That one is called Doppler spectrum. Okay? Now, so if somebody wants to simulate a narrowband signal, they have to simulate this Doppler, these variations of the channel. I mean, if you want to simulate a radio channel, a narrowband signal, you have to do this Doppler. How can you do that? You can design a filter similar to this and run it, for example, with a white noise. That's one way to do it. There are other ways. There's a Jake model, which just people have techniques to simulate these things. They have developed techniques. These variations. Okay. But these variations depends on this Doppler spectrum. So any standard who wants to tell you, I told you every standard is talking about what? A channel model. So you go to GSM, 802.11, UMTS, everybody, they have channel models of their own. What do they tell you with that channel model? One is the path loss that I told you a little bit earlier. About summary of that, and that's the one that we want to learn to work with in this course. But in addition to that, they come and they give you Doppler spectrum. Doppler spectrum is the one that is given in the standard. Okay? Now, so when they come for like indoor environment, a lot of people originally they tried to assume that this Doppler spectrum is like flat. So they were giving a flat spectrum. More recently, for example, in like 802.11n, actually Steve who did this thing, now he attends 802.11n. And they are going to things like this, which is more like a bell shape, Gaussian shape. Okay? But that's about the indoor. Because indoor is crazy, really. Not only we have variety of things, not only the models are not very accurate, okay, the bandwidths are also very wide. And so anyways, people come up with more number of models. And they are getting more and more curious about it. Okay, so when you go to mobile environment is a little bit more like interesting in a sense that if you remember like Akamura Hata model was very good for path loss. The behavior is more predictable in a sense. Okay, because typically you have an antenna and several buildings around it, whatever. I don't know. But indoor has more variety in it. Now, when you go to Doppler spectrum also, people originally actually, Clark, he did some sort of calculations. They call it circular scattering model. He developed and he predicted that Doppler spectrum is this double ear, has this double ear shape. So this is the maximum, and then in between is like double ear. It's given with an equation like this. Okay? Clark predicted that, and then Jake, these are in like around 70s. Jake developed a model to simulate this thing. And then people did measurement, and all the measurement fits this very, very closely. Very similar to Akamura and Hata's model. Okay, so all the standards, they give you something. For the cellular systems, they give you this double ear spectrum like this. Okay, for what? For Doppler spectrum. For the outside, outdoor. For indoor, either they say flat or they say something like a bell shape. So if you see like some of these standards, this is how you can read it. But what is the significance of this? If you want to simulate this narrowband variation of the signal, you have to design a filter like this, for example, and run it with white noise. In another word, your power spectrum of output of the signal means that you simulate a signal which is changing up and down. If you take the Fourier transform of that, it should come up to this shape. Okay, you need to have a trick for that. People have some tricks to implement, classical tricks. Okay. Now, if we so this is another thing that people talk about, like Doppler spectrum in the standards for the channel model. It's good to know about it in this course. Another thing is the so-called like type of fading. Type of fading, which usually is modeled by Rayleigh or Riesian. If you remember this multipath fading that we had, multipath fading was these variations. Or we had other figures. If you remember, this was multipath fading, these variations. Okay? If I want to find the Doppler spectrum, I get from here to here, I find a Fourier transform. That's my Doppler spectrum. Okay? And who is interested in that? The one who wants to simulate these things. Okay? There is another thing in here which we refer to that as multipath fading. Multipath fading is a statistics of these fluctuations. Means histogram of these fluctuations. Okay, so if I get point, 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 point of this, and I create a histogram, it has a statistic. Okay, that statistic is important. Who is interested in that? Those who want to calculate like probability of error, for example. Huh? Or they want to calculate how often you cross certain thresholds, how often your signal gets degraded too much. That's when you, that's what you get when you hit these fadings. Huh? I have to have some statistics of the fading. How often I get very, very low signal. Huh? For example, when I have these fadings and I have an analog system, whenever I go to deep fade and my signal level average is low, I hear some cups. Which means, I mean, signal dies, cup, 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 and then completely dies as I go away. Okay? If I have a digital system, whenever I go to deep fade, I may have a lot of errors in the receive signal. Okay? Now, so people who are designing modulation techniques, they are very interested in the statistics of variations of the signal. How can I calculate statistics of variation out of an experience? No problem. I get all the measurements at all the times. I create the histogram of that, and that histogram has a shape, and that's the probability density function of what? Of variations of the signal, or histogram of the signal. Okay? If you go for that, then usually people have two in the standards. Often they use two type of variations. One of them is Riesian, the other one is Rayleigh. Rayleigh distribution is a complex Gaussian distribution. Means that you have X and Y, each of them Gaussian random variable, and magnitude of that would be Riesian. Do you follow that? Magnitude of that would be Rayleigh. If I have two zero mean Gaussian random variable, one of them x, one of them y, if I get a square root of x square plus y square is Rayleigh random variable. Okay? And it's represented by this distribution. In a standard, the other one is Riesian distribution. Riesian distribution is the time that I have two Gaussian random variables which are not zero mean, and I add them together. Okay? And this is coming like this. Okay? Now, people who are doing modeling for amplitudes or histogram of the amplitude or statistics of variation of the amplitude, in all the standards, either they use Rayleigh or they use Rayleigh, most of them, either they use Rayleigh or Riesian. Riesian, they use it for the cases that you have line of sight. If you have line of sight between transmitter and receiver, there is one non-random constant element in there. Okay? And when you don't have line of sight connection between transmitter and receiver, they use Rayleigh, which is zero mean Gaussian, magnitude of zero mean two-dimensional Gaussian random variable. Okay? What are those two-dimensional, x and y, or in phase and quadrature phase, they call it, or magnitude and phase, if you want to call it. If you have two-dimensional Gaussian random variable, magnitude is Rayleigh, phase is uniform. Okay? But we don't care as much about the phase at this stage because we are only interested in the magnitude. So, Rayleigh and Riesian, if you open up any like a standard like recommendation, you see Rayleigh and Riesian for the amplitude fluctuations. Okay? Then the other thing is the shadow fading that earlier I told you about shadow fading. They model the shadow fading with log normal distribution, which is given in here. Basically, log normal means what? The dB version is logarithmic. And I said that before. So, based on that, and then if I look at now channel impulse response, Channel impulse response often is something like that. I have several paths, and these paths are moving up and down. You have some videos in the website that you can watch it, and it shows you these variations. Now, this is the impulse response. This is the frequency response, and all of these values are all the time changing. You look at that video, you will see it in practice in my WPI. Okay, but anyways, now I want to model that. If I want to model these paths, which are changing in time and changing in amplitude, changing in, it's very difficult. A standard organization, when they want to model, they assume that they have, I mean, up to now, up to recently, they were neglecting the fact that these paths are arriving randomly. So they would get cases like this. They would say, like in GSM, for example, or in UMTS, they say we have four fixed paths, and then each of these paths are moving Rayleigh, for example, or Riesian, and then they give you the Doppler spectrum of that. And that's the definition of a standard for the channel. And then they say, this is for urban areas, this is for suburban areas, this is for other things. And they have a path loss model. We don't do any of this type of thing in this course, but we do it in the other courses. But it's good for you to know only, okay, that a standard organization come up with charts like this. This is the so-called multipath profile, okay, which is time of arrival and strength of some paths, four paths, five paths, whatever, for every area, okay? So it's JTC for office environment, they give you one of this. For the commercial buildings, they give you another one. For residential, they give you another one. And for each of them, they identify this amplitude. They say that it changes either by Rayleigh or Riesian, and they give you a Doppler spectrum to implement it. Okay? This is summary of everything. But more recently, people are interested in angle of arrival, and then they're changing these models. So if you go to 802.11n, or you go to 802.15.3, the models, they are trying to model the arrival between the two paths as well. So they make it random. It's not fixed anymore. Okay. So that's the trend in channel modeling. So you go to GSM, you go to JTC, you have this thing fixed. But you go to newer versions, you see these things moving. Okay. Some of them moving, some of them not actually. People are working around this thing. When they are fixed, it's better because you can implement it easier with the software, with the hardware. So that's basically more or less what people need for channel modeling, really, or what people do for channel modeling. Okay. Now, one typical example is like JTC. This is the JTC. In JTC, they have like for residential buildings, for example. I told you they have residential, commercial, and offices. Now get the residential, for example. For the residential, they come and they give you three channels, channel A, B, C, bad house, medium house, good house, okay? And for each of them, they give you a profile. In this profile, this is amplitude of the first path and location of the first path. This is location of the second and amplitude of the second path. So if you want to sketch it, for example, and make it like the figure that I had, it would be something of this nature. So if you want to get that first path and sketch it, see, the first one was 0 dBm in 0 nanosecond. The second one was at 100 nanosecond and minus 13.8 dBm. So this is the profile. And then in the corner of the profile, they put a word like flat. Means that Doppler spectrum is flat. Okay? That's how they do it. So if you go now, back to the computer. See, this is like a model which is two paths, and these are the strength of the path. They are flat. For the flat means Doppler spectrum is flat. In addition to that, they also mean that fading is Rayleigh. They come together. Okay. Whenever it's not Rayleigh, they will say. Okay. So for the second one, for channel B, you have one path at 0, one at 100, one at 200, one at 300. And these are the strength of each other. And for channel C, you have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 path, and these are strength. So you have more multipath spread. In here, you have 600 nanosecond multipath spread. In here, you have 300. In here, you have 100. Okay? And that impulse function that you have in there, they refer to that impulse function, Q sub tau, or the so-called delay power spectrum. And then the function that we have flat, which is for Doppler spectrum, they call it D-nanda. Okay? D-nanda times Q sub nanda is a so-called scattering function, which represents the entire behavior of the channel. So when they want to model the channel, they give you Q sub tau, which is an impulse response, really. Okay? And then they give you D sub nanda, which tells you each of these impulses are changing at what form, according to what rule. Okay? These things at this class, only descriptive is enough, just to understand what is going on. We don't do any examples or any exercises on that. But just generally, you will have some idea. Okay? So that's about, like, material that I wanted to tell you about modeling. The last two slides that I have. So in summary, what I told you, I had a very, like, detailed description of calculation of the path loss for coverage. Then I had a very cursory, like, overview of how people model wideband, not narrowband. In wideband, you have several paths rather than one path. Okay? And now, in the last two slides, what I tell you is that how people use this thing, for example, for deployment tools or other tools. One of the tools that some people have are deployment tools. For example, if you are like in indoor environment, this is the first floor of Atwater Kent Laboratory. You can put your transmitter in here, and you have some model, whatever. It could be a statistical model, could be ray tracing, anything for a path loss. And then you will find out that how much this antenna is covering. See, it's not circle. It's something like this. You put another antenna in here, you will find it like this. Okay? This software originally was developed by Tim Holtz, and Yan Zhu actually changed it to like have more details in coverage and better interface. So two master students, they did it for their master thesis. But anyways, this is one atypical, in fact, software, ray tracing software, which was developed like early 90s, one of the oldest again available around. But you can use it for the coverage. But that's not only for this. You can get map of a town, and there are tools for that. You put the location of the antenna, it will tell you what is the coverage of that. There are softwares like that available. There are softwares like this available all over the place. So this is like software simulation for a study of the coverage. People have also real-time channel simulators. One of the real-time channel simulators that we are using in our lab is PropSim, which is actually designed with Electrobit in Oulu, Finland. And in this particular pieces of hardware, which are very expensive one, we paid like $250,000 for the one that we have in our lab. Okay, what you do is you simulate the channel and its variation with the hardware. This type of thing, who is using that? People who are designing modems. If I'm designing a modem, transmitter, and receiver, if I want to see what is the performance, I have to take it in the streets and walk and see how good it is. It's very expensive, and also I cannot repeat it. So as a result, I need like a hardware channel simulator that when I design the modem, I put the channels which are recommended by the standard on the piece of hardware, and I tweak my like modems with that. Okay. So the other one, so there are two type of like tools that I'm introducing in here. Tools, first set of tools are tools that I'm using for deployment, which are software tools, packages, and the other tools are hardware tools that use the channel models for laboratory test of the modems. Both of them are using what? Channel modeling as the core of what? Design of the tool. And in like something like PropSim, for example, you have like again an experiment in the MyWPI which shows that how they model the channel. These are those 5-6 tabs that you have that a standard organization like recommends that. But these tabs, these are one snapshot. They are always changing up and down. So if you go to one of the videos, you see how they go up and down. What they do, they take these up and downs and they simulate it in the piece of hardware in here. Okay? So when you put the modem in here, modem is exposed to a variety of conditions of multipath in the environment. So it's used for development. Without the channel model, I cannot design the modem and I cannot deploy the modem. I cannot deploy the system. So that's why that we need to model the channel. Okay? And that was the topic that we discovered or covered today. So in the last second summary, what I did, I tried to tell you the importance of channel modeling for the design and deployment of wireless networks. And in addition to that, I put like some emphasis on calculation of the path loss as some tool that you need to learn to continue to understand the deployment and coverage of wireless networks. Now, whether it is like a cellular network or it's a wireless LAN. Next week, we start to talk about deployment and issues related to deployment of wireless network. In there, we draw on channel model. And we'll see you guys next week.